I want you to open your Bibles with me to Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 20. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 20. My son, attend to my words. Incline thine ear unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart. For they, that is the words, and this is wisdom, words of wisdom. They are life unto those that find them, and health, and the margin of my Bible says medicine to all their flesh. And then I like verse 23, also keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Now, verse 7 of this same chapter, verse 7, Proverbs 4, 7 says, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. Exalt her, she shall promote thee. She shall bring thee to honor when thou dost embrace her. She shall give to thine head an ornament of grace, a crown of glory shall she deliver to thee. Hear, O my son, and receive my sayings, and the years of thy life shall be many. I have taught thee in the way of wisdom. I have led thee in right paths. So then you come down to verse 20, and it's still talking about wisdom or words of wisdom. Well, that would be the word of God and the understanding of the word of God. I'm reminded of something that Jesus said in John 15 and verse 7. If ye abide in me and my words, and there is plural, words, abide in you. You'll ask what you will, and it shall be done. Well, the word of God, the wisdom of God, the words of God, and there it says you'll ask what you will. Doesn't say you'll ask what God wills, but it is in line with his word because his words are abiding in you. When his words are abiding in you, why would you ask anything not in line with his word? But this is what you will. And it'll be done. Not what God wills, what you will. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, then you'll ask. You'll ask what you will and it'll be done. So my son, attend to my words. Now the word attend gives the emphasis. This is something that's of a priority of importance. For example, in Matthew 6, Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and these things will be added. What things? Well, the things the Gentiles are seeking. What will we eat? What will we drink? How will we be clothed? Or what will we wear? He said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. These things will be added. Seeking first means it's a priority. That's not the only thing you're doing, but it's the priority of your life. The kingdom of God and the righteousness of God, living for God, is a priority. Well, that's what he means, attend. This is something that has a priority. It's of importance. For example, you might tell somebody, I have something I must attend to. That means it's important to you. It's a priority. Other things may be in your day, but this is having a priority. Will you do this? Well, I have something I must attend to first. Well, will you go here with me? No, I have something I must attend to. That doesn't mean you don't want to do that other, but this is a priority. Attend to my words makes it a priority. I think with some people, it's not a priority. It's just sort of when they have a convenient time or it's sort of, down the list, not even second or third, just down the list when they have time, they'll get to that. Well, things that are seeking first, it's not when you have time. Things that are a priority, it's not just when it's convenient. So when I make sure that the word of God is treasure that I'm desiring, that I'm seeking, like in the parable where Jesus said, a man hears about a treasure hidden in a field, so he spends all he has to buy that field because he wants that treasure. When you have the desire for God and the kingdom of God with that kind of desire that you see God is treasure and you're just willing to do what you can to get that, then it's going to work for you. So, my son, attend to my words, incline thine ear unto my sayings. Have the inclination to hear. And then keep that inclination even when it seems like circumstances are contrary. I've talked to people and they're going through a battle, a hard place, and you want to give them some encouragement. And sometimes people are at the place where they just don't want to hear it anymore. In fact, they'll put their hand up and quieten you down. And just, I've had them just look me in the eye and say, I don't want to hear that. They just put a hand up in my face and look me in the eye, says, I don't want to hear that. I've heard that. I don't want to hear that. I can think of a few. I won't go into all of the details or the specifics, but I'm thinking of people right now where I've had that experience. They'll put a hand up and they don't want to be impolite. They don't mean to, you know, be disrespectful, but they just, sometimes, I don't know if that's true of every person. Sometimes I think they don't mind, but they'll put a hand up and look me in the eye. I don't want to hear that. Well, this tells you to hear it. Incline thine ear. I'm going to hear the sayings of God, whether I feel good or feel bad, whether things are going good, things are not going good in the circumstances. Incline thine ear unto my sayings. Let them not depart from before thine eyes. And not only natural eyes, not only physical eyes, but spiritual eyes. That is, see it on the inside. Imagine on the inside the word of God working for you. Meditate and imagine, ponder, set your focus on the provision of God, the promise of God, the word of God, and see it. When the circumstances are saying one thing, and that's what you're seeing with the physical eye, on the inside, see it being the way God has said. See it being the way the word of God has declared. What God has provided, what God has promised, what you see in the word of God, on the inside, see it. And don't let that depart from before your eyes. You can keep the word of God in front of your physical eyes, but I think it's also important to keep the word of God in your spiritual eyes, where you see the word of God happening to you. It shall be, even as it was told me, what Paul said in Acts 27, verse 25. Abraham considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith. And so even though circumstances was contrary, he was strong in faith, giving glory to God, because he was fully persuaded what he'd promised, he's able to perform. He was seeing it, and actually he was also saying it. He called himself Abraham, and he called things which be not as though they were, even when it looked like there was no way. In fact, when there was no hope, he believed in hope, that he would become that which God has said, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. This is in Romans chapter 4. And so he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old. So the circumstances said it's not going to happen, but he saw it. So don't let the word of God depart from before your eyes. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Well, then it also says, keep them in the midst of thine heart. That is by meditating, pondering, focusing. You're not going to let it leave your heart. Your circumstances, even your thought life. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 10, for you to bring thoughts captive to the obedience of Christ. He said to cast down imaginations. And the imagination there, again, it's an image. This image comes to your thought life to see doubt and failure and defeat. Well, that imagination that comes, cast that down. Bring every thought into captivity. It's exalting itself against the knowledge of God. The way an idol, the idol or the image, the idol, the false god. This is really metaphorically referring to in the Old Testament. They were told to tear down the graven images and the idols and the false gods. Well, the image is imagination in your mind. It's something that's exalting itself against the knowledge of God. God has said this, but the circumstances say that. Well, don't put the circumstances above God. Don't set that at a higher place. Don't exalt that above God. Don't make an idol above God. God is God. Every other God or idol or false god or image is to be cast down. They were to tear down the graven images. They were to have no other god except God. Well, when something comes to your mind that's exalting itself against the knowledge of God, that's trying to become an idol, where you're focused on it instead of God. When you have your attention on something other than God, then that's stealing your attention and becoming a false god. Can somebody say amen? Does anybody see the analogy here? So I'm to cast it down. I'm to take it captive. And I'm to pull down the stronghold. That stronghold is in my mind. That's what he said in 2 Corinthians 10, pulling down strongholds. That's not demons out there somewhere. That's the thoughts in my mind that are trying to become a stronghold in my mind. So I'm to keep the word of God in my heart. I'm to not let the word of God depart from before my eyes. I'm not to let doubt or unbelief enter into my heart. And that's what this is telling me. If I'll do that, then I'll find that the word of God is life. The word of God is life. I need to find it. That is, I need to study to show myself approved. I need to sometimes burn the midnight oil, so to speak, and be diligent. Diligence is a part of this. What does that mean? Well, people that go to the gym and work out usually are stronger than the people who don't. Well, God was really good to that person. Look how strong he is. Well, he had something to do. You know, God really gave him a lot of muscle. God's been good to him. Well, he had something to do. Can somebody say amen? And so spiritually speaking, the same thing applies. That's why Hebrews chapter 11, Hebrews 11, 6 says, God's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. When I diligently apply the things of God in my life, I'm going to have more results than if I don't diligently apply the things of God. This isn't works. We're not saved this way. We're saved by grace through faith, not by works. But after I'm saved, I'm ordained unto good works that I should walk in them, and I need to be diligent to seek first the kingdom of God. And God will respond to that. He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. I'm not saved by works, but I do receive rewards and the effects of spending time in his word. He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Can somebody say amen? And so that's what this is saying. Find the word of God. Find the word of God. That is, you study, you seek, you desire, you desire to learn. You go to the Lord and say, open the eyes of my heart, my understanding, my ears, my eyes. I want to understand your word. I want to have the understanding of your word. Help me to see it. Help me to hear it. Help me to know it. Help me to understand it. And then James said, be doers of the word and not hearers only. And so when you find the word of God, this says you'll have life. And not only that, health or medicine to the flesh. God's interested in your flesh. God's interested in the life of your spirit, but the well-being of your flesh. Medicine to your flesh. And medicine in the natural, medicine won't work for you if you don't take it. Just having it on the counter doesn't mean it'll do any good. You have to take it. And then often medicine has directions. And you have to take it according to the prescription or as directed, or it won't work for you like it should. If it says take it every 4 hours and you only take it every 4 days, it probably will not produce the effect that it should. Is that right or not? Well, God's medicine has some directions. And if we would be as diligent about God's medicine as most people are with natural medicine, the things of God would work better for us. I mean, some people will come to church for prayer one time, and then if they don't get what they came for, they don't come back. Who does a doctor that way? The doctor says, come back next Thursday, and I'll see you again. They go right there. They're sometimes early. They'll wait in the waiting room for hours to see that doctor when they just saw him 2 days ago. Well, I want to see you again in 2 weeks. They're right there. And sometimes they'll wait for hours in that waiting room, reading the magazine or whatever they're doing, to see that doctor they just saw 2 weeks ago. But a preacher will tell people, now, won't you come next service? Well, I didn't get what I came for, so I'm going to go somewhere else because you ain't got it. If we do the doctor that way, why can't we do God that way? If we go to the doctor and he says, come back, and you go back, why can't we go to the preacher and he says, come back, and we go back? And he says, now take this every 4 hours. Let a preacher give somebody a scripture and say, read this every 4 hours and see if they do it. Yeah, but I want my healing. Well, read this every 4 hours. You mean God's not going to just heal me? This says the word of God is medicine. I have found that to be true. The word of God is medicine. When I will feed on the word of God, it produces an effect in my physical body. The word of God is healing to my flesh. The word of God is medicine to my flesh. He sent his word and healed me. The word of God is medicine to my flesh. Life, 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 and medicine. healing and health and life and strength and peace and glory and praise God, the Word of God produces in me. And I'm thankful to Him because He sent His Word, and I thank Him. Jesus is the Word made flesh. He reveals the written Word by the Spirit of God unto my heart. The living Word is revealing the written Word, and He sent His Word, and I receive His Word. And the Word of God is life. The Word of God is medicine. The Word of God is healing. In health, the Word of God. Praise God for the Word of God. Praise God for the Spirit of God to reveal the Word of God. Praise God for the living Word, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Oh, unto God be all praise and glory and strength. Oh, unto God be all praise and glory and adoration and majesty. God is worthy of our praise. Can somebody say amen? Hallelujah. Whew. The Word of God puts me over. The Word of God puts me over. And then the next verse, verse 23. Keep. That word keep means protect and guard your heart. And be diligent about it. Because out of your heart are the issues of life. Put the Word of God in. The Word of God comes out. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, he could have used this text, this as his text. In Matthew 12, he could have used Proverbs 4:23 as his text. When he said, a good man out of the good treasure of the heart brings forth good things. But an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart, he brings forth evil things. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Jesus could have used Proverbs 4:23 as his text when he preached, the good man out of the good treasure of his heart, he brings forth good things. How? Out of that good treasure of his heart. But the evil man, he brings forth evil things. How? Out of the evil treasure of his heart. So guard, protect, keep your heart with all diligence, because out of it are the issues of life. Put the Word of God in your heart. The Word of God will come out of your mouth, and it will affect your lifestyle. It will affect your life. The Word of God is life to those that find them. The Word of God is healing and health and life and strength and medicine to the flesh. So guard your heart with all diligence, because out of your heart are the issues of life. Put the Word of God in your heart. The Word of God comes out of your heart. When the Word of God comes out of your heart and out of your mouth and speaking forth according to the will of God, Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then you'll ask what you will, and then it'll be done. Can somebody say amen? Whew. Can you raise your hands and just thank Him for His Word? Thank Him for the Word which you've heard. Thank Him for the Word which you've heard. Continuing to hear, continuing to hear, because the Word of God is so dear. The desire to know, the desire to grow. Thank you, Father, for your Word. The Word of God produces results. You watch over your Word to perform it. You hasten your Word to perform it. You confirm your Word with signs following. Thank you for your Word. Thank you for you. Thank you for you. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Said out loud, the Word is working mightily in me. Say it again. The Word is working mightily in me. Say it again. The Word is working mightily in me. Say it again. The Word is working mightily in me. The rest of that song is, no matter what the circumstance, what I feel or see, the Word is working mightily in me. Glory, glory, glory. I'm glad. Amen. Amen. Amen.